Jesus talked about four kinds of ground: the wayside, the stony ground, the thorny ground, and the good ground. In Matthew 13, the wayside, there it says they heard the word of God but didn't understand it. And Satan came immediately and took the word. The good ground, now it's also in Mark 4. It's also in Luke 8. The good ground in Luke 8, it says there that the person understood it. So in both of those places, referring to the ground. Matthew said the wayside didn't understand it. Luke said the good ground did understand it. It won't work if you don't understand it. You don't understand it completely. Jesus said, Mark 4:26, the kingdom of God operates as if man should cast seed in the ground, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. Well, you don't entirely know how it operates. It'll still work for you, even if you don't understand it completely. But you do have to understand it well enough to know to sow the seed. And he said the whole kingdom of God operates this way, as if man should cast seed in the ground, and the seed should spring and grow up, he knoweth not how. For the earth bringeth forth fruit of her, and he sleeps and rises night and day. You can sleep part of the time. Sleep and rise night and day. The earth brings forth fruit of herself. First the blade, then the ear, after that the full corn in the ear. When the fruit is brought forth immediately, he puts in the sickle because the harvest has come. You don't understand it completely, and you can even sleep part of the time. You have to be diligent enough to tend to it, but you don't have to be out there 24/7. And you don't have to understand it completely, but you do have to understand it well enough to cooperate with the process and how the process works. Again, in Mark 4, the parable of the seed, Matthew 13, Matthew says some things Mark doesn't, that Luke doesn't, and vice versa. In Matthew 13, the wayside didn't understand it. In Luke chapter 8, the good ground did understand it. Now, in Matthew 13, also around verse 15, Jesus said this people's heart is wax gross. Their ears are dull of hearing. Their eyes they've closed. But at any time, if they would see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and then notice the next part, and understand with their hearts and be converted. At any time you can understand. If you ask God for the understanding, that's why James said in James chapter 1, if you lack wisdom, ask God, and he gives liberally and upbraideth not. We can understand if we desire to, and God responds to desire. So Lord, give me the understanding. Help me see this. I don't see it, but I want to see it. And ask in faith, nothing wavering, he gives liberally and upbraideth not. So Jesus said, Matthew 13, 15, at any time. So the person that's the wayside, he doesn't understand it. He could if he would, if he had desired to. The stony ground that is offended afterward when affliction and persecution ariseth for the word's sake. They don't have to be offended. They can say, Lord, help me see this. I loved it at first. They received the word of God with gladness. And then they change when the affliction and persecution arises. Well, they don't have to change. They could ask God for understanding. Why is the affliction and the persecution arising when I receive the word with gladness? The affliction and persecution is contrary to your word. Why is this working this way? Your word says this, and yet the circumstances say that. Why is it working this way? Well, if you ask for understanding and decide not to get offended, I'm not going to get offended. I'm not going to quit. The stony ground doesn't have to get offended. He could change if he would. And that's why Jesus said at any time, if they would just decide to change and see with their eyes and understand with their, or hear with their ears and understand with their heart. It won't work if you don't understand it. And God wants us to. And he's ready and able and willing to respond to our hunger. They that hunger and thirst after righteousness will be filled. They that are diligent, that see, they see the things of God and the kingdom of God as treasure hidden in a field. They just want to spend everything they have and buy that field. Then it works for them. That if you seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, then it'll work for you. It's impossible to please him without faith. And they that come to God must believe that he is and that he's a rewarder of those who casually seek him. No, diligent. So the desire is what moves God, and God gives us the understanding. At any time, if they would hear with their ears, see with their eyes, and understand with their heart and be converted, then I would respond. I'd heal them. I'd bless them, deliver them, respond to them. Well, people come to me and say, well, what about that? I'm not supposed to say it's coming. One thing that I like to say in response to that is if you keep in mind that the whole kingdom of God operates like a seed. Jesus said it did. And then if you understand how a seed operates, you can understand how the kingdom of God operates. Faith is like the word of God planted in your heart, like a seed, a kernel of corn planted in the ground. Well, when you plant it, that part is done. You don't do that again. That part is complete. That part is past tense. I have planted that kernel of corn in the ground. That's past tense. Now, what's next? Well, the present tense, I have tend to it. Have to weed it, have to water it, have to tend to it. The future tense is it's coming. So all three are involved, but I have to understand that I have planted it, I am tending to it, and it is coming. If I say that the things of God, the answers to my prayer, the desires of my heart according to his provision and his word is coming, I have to know that I have planted it in my heart. And once I've planted in my heart, that process, that part of the process is complete. I don't have to do that again. When I'm shopping on Amazon, the part of the shopping cart has been completed when the order has been finalized, even though I don't have it yet. So I can say it's coming, but it's only the only reason it's coming is because I have completed the process of the shopping cart. And if you're watching my lifestyle, you'd know that I believe that because I stopped shopping. I'm not trying to still get it. If you observe my lifestyle, you know what I believe because he finished the process of the shopping cart and he's not shopping anymore. He's expecting it to come based on what he has done. Well, the word of God is that way. It's just that sure. It's more sure. God is more faithful than Amazon. If I have believed, I've received. And that's what Jesus said in Mark 11:24. What things soever you desire when you pray, believe. Well, the moment that I pray is when I believe. But in Mark 11:24, he didn't say, now make sure you always say, I have it now. In fact, he didn't say for you to say, I have it now. He said, you will have it. Is that what it says? Well, if people don't understand it, that's confusing. You mean I can't say I will have it? Well, certainly you can say that. Jesus said that. You can say what he said, but why did he say that? The reason you will have it is because you have believed, you received, and you did that when you prayed. And when you know that you have believed that you received, then you will have it. Now, faith, Hebrews 11:1 says it's the substance of our hope. It does not say there it gives us hope. The word of God does two things. It gives you hope, but it also gives you faith. But faith doesn't give you the hope. That's not what it says. I've heard preachers misquote that. And the reason they misquote it, it isn't because they have some translation. I've read this verse in many translations. They misquote it because they don't understand it. Faith is the substance of my hope. It is what gives substance to my hope. It is the tangible materiality in the spirit realm of what I'm desiring. Because the spirit realm created the natural realm. The spirit realm is more real than the natural realm. God is a spirit, and God is more real than anything in the natural. He created the spiritual world. He created the natural world. The spiritual world is more real, and the spiritual world has substance. All of the natural world was created by the spiritual world. God is a spirit. The words that Jesus spoke, he said, they are spirit and they are life. That is, there is in the spirit realm materiality to the word of God. The substance in the spirit realm is the word of God. God created all of creation by his word and with his word. And he's upholding all things by the word of his power, according to Hebrews chapter 1. So the substance of what I hope is the faith that comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. The word of God is what gives substance. When I believe it, my faith, believing his word, is what actually creates what I hope. It's the substance to my hope. But it's also something else. Hebrews 11:1 says it's something else. It's the evidence that I have something I do not see. Well, there, I have it now. I don't see it. I can't feel it. I can't handle it. I can't show it to anybody. I can't use it. If I've ordered something from Amazon, I can't use it until it arrives, even though I believe I have received and I believe it is coming. But shopping cart procedure and process, my credit card and their process is the substance that causes that order to be finalized, created, and then finalized. But I can't use it yet, but I'm believing it's coming because I'm believing that I've already finished the process that's required to cause it to come. Well, my faith in God's word is what causes it to be created, and my faith in God's word is my confidence that I have it and it's coming. So it's future tense and I have it now. Well, where do I have it? In the unseen realm. It's the evidence of things that I do not see. I don't see it. I don't feel it. I can't handle it. I can't use it. I can't show it to anybody. I can't give the testimony, even though my faith says I have it. It's the evidence of what I do not see, so I have it now. Well, this is how God created everything. In fact, verse 3 there in Hebrews 11, it says, through faith we understand that the worlds, now worlds is plural, spiritual world and natural world. He created the spiritual world. He created the natural world. How did he do it? Well, through faith we understand these worlds were created by the word of God. He spoke it. Well, he believed what he said, and he got what he said. And not only does it say that they were created, the worlds were created framed by the word of God. It says things which do appear were not made of things, or things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. The things which are seen, they were not made of things which do appear. Words don't appear. You don't see words. So the words are that which does not appear, but the words that don't appear created everything that does appear. Things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. Another way to phrase that is things which are seen were not made of things which are seen. Things which are seen were not made of things which are seen. That's another way to say that. Through faith, we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God so that things which are seen were not made of things which are seen. You don't see your words, but your words create things that you do see. So there's a visible realm and an invisible realm. There's a visible world and an invisible world. Well, healing for the sick person exists in the invisible world. The sickness for the sick person exists in the visible world. Or the seen and the unseen. There's the seen and the unseen. Or you feel it and you don't feel it. The feeling, the sense realm, the seen realm, the visible realm. Or the unseen realm, the invisible realm, where you don't have the feeling. The person that feels sick, the word of God has already declared by whose stripes ye were healed, but that's in the unseen, in the invisible, in the realm where you don't feel it. What you do feel is real, but what you don't feel is also real. What you do see is real, but what you don't see is also real. Now, where you put the focus, what you dwell on, focus on, meditate on, where you put your magnifying glass of your spirit, that will get bigger in you. If you focus on the healing, even when you don't see it, even when you don't feel it, it will begin to materialize just like a seed. Because Jesus said the whole kingdom of God operates this way. You put the seed in the ground. When you do, you don't see it anymore. It's in the unseen realm. When you put the seed in the ground, you cover it over and you don't see it. But it's the evidence of what's coming. Now, why is it coming? Because you planted it. That's past tense. And you're tending to it. That's present tense. So you've got to have the past and the present tense before you're ever going to have the future tense. People who are putting everything off into the future, very often they've never done anything in the past tense. I believe God's going to do something one day. Well, why do you believe that? Well, because His Word promised it. But have you believed you've received when you've prayed? Just because He promised it doesn't mean it's going to happen to you. The Word of God has to be planted in you. And when you believe that you receive when you pray, then Jesus said you'll have it. Just because kernels of corn exist doesn't mean you're going to have corn. That's God's system. That's God's creation. He created corn. But until you plant it, you aren't going to have a garden of corn. But when you plant your corn in your garden, then you will have corn. Even though God designed it and created it, it won't happen for you until you plant it. And when you do, it's in the unseen realm, past tense. Now, present tense, you deal with it or tend to it and work with it and continue to maintain your garden and continue to maintain what's necessary for it to grow. And then you will have it, future tense. Jesus said the whole kingdom of God operates this way. So I've got the unseen realm. That's why Jesus said in Mark 11:23, that whosoever shall say to this mountain, be removed and be cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but believe the things that he says shall come to pass. He'll have what he says. The doubt and the believing is in the heart. You're talking to something that's seen, but the doubt and the believing is in the unseen realm. That's why when he cursed the fig tree earlier in Mark 11, it says, when Peter called into remembrance, said, Master, behold, the fig tree which you cursed is withered away. The Bible says that it dried up from the root. The root system is the unseen realm. The root system is where you don't see. That's where Jesus spoke. That's where it dried up. And when it dried up from the roots and withered away, then it caused the rest of the tree to respond. But the first place it responded was in the root system. Verse 20, in the morning as they passed by, they saw the fig tree dried up from the where? The roots. He spoke to the source of the problem. He's not so much as talking to the tree as he is the roots of the tree. And if you don't deal with the roots, then that tree's going to come back anyway. And after you deal with the roots, it doesn't matter what the tree looks like. It's going to follow the condition of the roots. It may look alive and healthy, but if the root system is dead, that tree's going to follow. The tree is going to follow the roots. And if the roots are diseased and decayed and dead, the tree is going to look that way soon enough. That's why he said in Luke 17:6, if you have faith as a mustard seed, you'd say to the fig tree, be plucked up by the root and planted in the sea. He's talking about the unseen realm. Well, I have healing, even though I feel sick. I'm going to focus on the healing. Now, I can say as far as the spirit realm is concerned, because people might say, well, is it all right for me to say I'm not sick? As long as you understand you're talking about the spirit realm, because in the natural realm, any doctor would diagnose you and say you are. So as long as you understand what you're talking about, I'm talking about the spirit realm, and that's who I am. I'm a spirit, and I have the word of God, which is spirit. Jesus said, the words that I speak, they are spirit and life, and the word is creating and producing results. And in the spirit realm, I don't have that. Well, what do you have? I have healing. Now, I would rather, it's my preference to say I have healing, because the healing I have will overcome the sickness. The sickness may be in my body, but the healing is in the spirit realm. Well, I have both. I'm going to dwell on the one in the unseen, and the unseen will overcome the seen. But if somebody said, I'm not sick, as long as they understand what they're saying, that's still true. The devil may fight them and say, you're just lying. People may be confused and they'll pull at you. But as long as you understand, I'm talking about the spirit realm. In the spirit realm, that doesn't exist. What does exist is healing. But I think it's better to emphasize what you have by the word of God, and it'll overcome what the natural says. And so you can't go by what you see. And the moment you ask for prayer again, I mean the next day, I don't mean weeks later or somebody with a special anointing. And when that's the case, you need to know what you're doing. But the next day you don't feel any better, so you ask somebody else for prayer. You're reattaching it. If it ever was cursed from the roots, you just reattached it. Because the root system is where the power is. Be plucked up, Luke 17:6, by the root. And planted into the sea. It withered from the roots, dried up from the roots. And they saw that it withered. But it first dried up from the roots. The withering came later. The withering came later. The withering came later. The tree looked alive when it was dead. You can't go by what you see. And you can go to the doctor, and the doctor says it's still there. Well, it may still be there, but it's dead. But see, most Christians don't believe that. They'll believe the doctor. And the moment they believe the doctor, they reattach it. And it's back attached to the life source again. Because they walk by sight, not by faith. They go by what they see, not what they believe. The horticulturist looks at the tree and the tree looks alive. If he doesn't examine the root system, he's an expert. If he doesn't examine the root system, that tree's alive. Well, he's an expert. I mean, we just have to be honest. That tree's alive. What makes you say that? You're going by what you see. You have to be. Because if you go by what the word of God says, it's not alive. Jesus said, when you speak to it and don't doubt in your heart, it'll obey you. The fig tree will obey you. You'll not only do this, which I did the fig tree, the mountain will obey you. The sycamine tree will obey you. Well, Jesus isn't mistaken about all of this. He's not wrong. It's what we believe. Well, the moment you believe what you see, you reattach it. The doctor says, let's say the horticulturist is examining the tree, or the doctor is examining the body. And he says, well, that sickness is still there. The horticulturist is the expert. He said, that tree's still alive. As long as he doesn't look at the root. Now see, sickness, the root system of the sickness is the spirit realm. The doctor cannot see the spirit realm. So he has to go by the natural realm. That's all he knows. The horticulturist, in the natural, he could examine the roots, but in the parallel, in the example, in the metaphor, the root system is the spirit realm. So get the expert to examine this tree, but tell him, don't look at the roots, and then give me your assessment. Well, he'll tell you that tree's alive. The doctor will say you've still got it. Now, if you believe that, you've reattached it in the spirit realm to the root system, and it'll thrive. It'll grow right back and thrive. That's why he said, if you don't doubt in your heart, but believe what you say will come to pass, you'll have what you say. He said, the mountain will obey you. The fig tree will obey you. The sycamine tree will obey you. Well, Jesus, I tried that and it didn't work. He's never going to say, oh, my mistake. The reason it doesn't obey is because we doubt it in our heart. And Jesus is operating in full faith and full power. Not everything with us is the next day. But the principle of faith still works exactly the same way. That tree is dead and it will wither and show that it's dead. See, it didn't say it died the next day. It says it withered the next day. Or the next day they saw that it withered. It didn't die the next day. It died when he spoke to it. But it didn't look dead until the next day. So it's what you go by. And then it's what you talk about. If you talk about the seen realm, you're going to have the seen realm. Now, when Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, he said to his disciples, he's asleep. He's trying to talk faith. Well, he is talking faith, trying to get them to understand. They didn't understand. So he had to speak plain. And he said, Lazarus has died. The King James Version said, Lazarus is dead. But I've looked at two literal versions, and both of the literal versions I've looked at say it's past tense. I believe Jesus spoke in the past tense. I don't believe he wanted to establish the present tense by saying he is dead. I believe the literal Greek is exactly the way the two translations I looked at say that it is. Lazarus has died. Past tense. If you'll discipline yourself to talk about the unwanted natural circumstances in the past tense, you'll have more success. Because faith is present tense and it involves what's coming based on the past and the present. Faith is something that you have believed and are tending to, and now it will come based on those two truths. But the natural realm, he said Lazarus has died. Now, faith will talk that way. Well, he's asleep. Yeah, but the doctor examined him and said he's dead. Well, Jesus didn't go by what the doctor said. Jesus went by what he believed. And, well, I know he's dead. But he talked out loud, he's died. He didn't even want to say he's dead in the present tense. And he's trying to talk faith to them. Well, he is talking faith. He's trying to get them to understand it. They didn't understand it. So he said plainly, Lazarus has died. When he raised Jairus' daughter from the dead, he said, why are you making this ado? She's not dead. In the Greek, I've looked at two translations. She has not died. Put it in the past tense. She has not died, but she is, that's present tense, she is asleep. He's talking faith. And they didn't understand him. In fact, they laughed him to scorn. And I found out today that there's some Pentecostal preachers that'll laugh you to scorn because they don't understand faith. They don't understand the language. In Romans chapter 4, verse 16, it says, therefore, it is of faith that it might be by grace. God's grace is in place, but it's the faith that receives his grace. To the end, the promise might be sure to all the seed, not to that only which is of the law, but to that also which is of the faith of Abraham, who is the father of us all. As it is written, I have made thee a father of many nations, before him whom he believed, even God, who quickeneth the dead. Now, quicken means gives life. And the dead here is that which isn't doing anything on its own. It has life potential, but it's like the seed is dead if it abides alone. It has life potential. The seed, until it's planted, does not produce life. God quickens the dead, or he gives life to the seed, but not until it's planted. So this is the seed that has life potential. When it's planted, God is the one that produces the life from the seed and by the seed and through the seed. God quickens the dead. Now, how does he do that? He calls things which be not as though they were. So this is two realms, the natural realm, the supernatural realm, the spiritual realm, the physical realm, the seen realm, the unseen realm, the visible realm, the invisible realm, where you feel, where you don't have the feeling. It's the two realms or the two worlds. He calls things which be not, that is, it's not here in the physical, but he calls it as though it was. Now, how did he do that? He called himself the father of nations when he didn't have any children, because God called him the father of many nations when he didn't have any children. Well, if God can call him Abraham the father of many nations when he doesn't have the promised child, we're not talking about Ishmael. We're talking about the child of promise. We're talking about Isaac. Well, he doesn't have the promised child, and yet God's calling him the father of many nations when he doesn't have the many nations. Well, if God can do that, and he's telling me to do that, changing my name so I will do that, I'm going to do it too. I'm going to call myself something that does not appear. It doesn't look that way to anybody else looking at me. It doesn't feel that way. It doesn't look that way. And so it's the invisible and the visible, the unseen and the seen realm. So being not weak in faith, he considered not his own body. That means he didn't consider how it looks. He didn't look at the visible, the physical, the natural. Well, he would have been weak in faith if he had considered his own body now dead. Weak faith considers the circumstances. He was not weak. He didn't consider the circumstances. That doesn't mean you don't deny it. That, or that you do deny it. That doesn't mean it's you have self-denial. Or I don't believe that really exists. It exists, but he's not considering it. That doesn't mean you're not, that you just refuse to, that you deny it, its existence. It does exist, but you don't consider it. I know that it's here. I know I feel this. I know I see this, but I'm not considering it. So it's where you're focusing. It's where you're putting your attention. It's what you're talking about. He called himself Abraham when he was not the father of many nations, according to what has been spoken. So he believed God. He believed what was spoken. And God said, so shall thy seed be. Verse 18 says, he believed that which was spoken. So faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. It has to be based on the word of God. He believed that which was spoken. So shall thy seed be. And when the circumstances look differently, he didn't consider them. How do you know he didn't consider them? He's not talking about them. What is he talking about? He's considering what God said and calling things which be not as though they were. He staggered not at the promise of God through unbelief. Verse 20 says, and he was strong in faith, giving glory to God and being fully persuaded. God promised it. He's able to perform it. So that's the way it's going to be. So shall thy seed be is future tense. I have made thee the father of many nations is past tense. And people are confused by that. Well, am I not supposed to say it's coming? Well, he said it's coming. So shall thy seed be. That's future tense. But it's only and always based upon your believing something in the past tense. I have made thee. See, that's past tense. I have made thee. Verse 17, that's past tense. I have made thee a father of many nations. Well, I don't have any children. I mean, of the promise. You understand what I mean by that. I don't have any children. Well, I've made you a father of many nations. Well, what are you going to believe? Are you going to believe what you see? Or are you going to believe what you don't see? He called things which be not as though they were, and he believed. He staggered not at the promise. He believed according to that which was spoken. Well, what is spoken? So shall thy seed be. It's like Paul in Acts 27. I believe God that it shall be, even as it was told me. What God promised me is coming, and I believe I have received it, and I'm not going to stagger at the promise of God through unbelief. I'm going to be fully persuaded. He's able, he's promised it, he's able to perform it, and I'll just be strong in faith and give glory to God for it now. Now, the seen realm and the unseen realm, he's calling things which be not as though they were. He's looking at the seen realm, but he's calling the things that are not seen, things which be not. The sick person can say, by whose stripes I was healed. Well, how do you feel? I don't talk about my feelings. I believe by whose stripes I was healed. Well, how do you feel? It's not important how I feel. I mean, I'm not talking to the doctor. You're not trying to diagnose the physical realm. The horticulturist is going to tell me the tree's alive, but I believe it's been cursed from the roots and it's drying, it's dead, it's going to wither away, and I believe what's coming. Well, how do you feel? I'd rather talk about what I believe. Well, what do you believe? Now, he didn't call things which be not as though, no, let me back up. He did call things which be not as though they were. He didn't call things which be as though they were not. He didn't talk about things that be as though they were not. He talked about things that were not as though they were. He didn't talk about things that are as though they weren't. He talked about things that weren't as though they were. He didn't talk about things that are as though they weren't. He talked about things that weren't as though they were. And were is past tense. I mean, are is true, but were is better because you're talking still past tense. It's as good as done. He didn't talk about things that are as though they weren't. He talked about things that weren't as though they were. And faith will do that. One more verse before we close on this topic. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 27. God is chosen. Everybody say it out loud. God has chosen. Say it again. Say it again. Say it again. So this is God's idea. God has chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise. God has chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are. God's chosen this. He's chosen the spiritual realm to bring to naught the natural realm. Well, if sickness is in the natural realm, what am I going to do about it? The doctors will treat it. They're treating symptoms. That's all they know. Well, sometimes that's really important, especially if that's all you have. That's good, because God has designed the physical body to try to recover and repair itself. That's his design. But God's faith system is the thing that isn't to bring to naught the things that is. Well, in the natural realm, in the physical world, healing is a be not. And Abraham, because God did, called things which be not. Well, in the physical realm, the sick person doesn't have the healing. Healing's a be not. Well, call things which be not. That is, call yourself well. And God has chosen the things which are not. Well, that's an are not. The sick person are not healed in the natural realm, in the physical realm. That's an are not. He doesn't have the healing where the doctor would confirm, oh, yes, you're well, because it's only in the spirit realm. It's not in the natural realm, but it still is there in one of those worlds. And we live in both worlds at the same time. So I have healing the same time sickness is here. It's which one do you see? Well, I see the sickness. I don't see the healing, but I have the healing. It's in the spirit realm, by whose stripes you were healed. And the word is spirit and life. Jesus said, the words that I speak are spirit and they are life. And Abraham called things which be not as though they were. And God has chosen this as his system. It's the word of God as a seed that is planted into the unseen realm. You put it in the dirt, you put it in the ground, you cover it over. And the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. And the healing that is going to be seen is not created by healing that first appears. It first is words. Words don't appear. The healing that creates the physical healing is first in the spirit realm, words. And the words are planted in your heart. And God has, through faith, we understand the worlds were framed by the word of God. So the things which are seen were not made of things which do appear. And my words are spirit and they are life. And it's just like a seed that's planted in the ground and you cover it over and it's in the unseen realm, but it produces results in the seen realm. And God's chosen this. He uses the things which are not to bring to naught the things that are. Well, the sick person, the are is the sickness. I are sick. And so what's going to push that sickness out of the way and bring it to nothing? The healing is. And the healing is in are not. It's in the spirit realm. It are not in the physical realm. You understand my phraseology? God has chosen things which are not to bring to naught things which are. I have to believe the word of God by faith before I feel it, before I see it, and consider not what I feel and consider not what I see, and call things which be not as though they were. And the system that God has chosen is his word produces results and pushes out of the physical realm, the undesired. The sickness is undesired. The healing pushes it out. It overcomes it. It causes it to be reduced to nothing. Well, the tree looked alive. He cursed it with words. And that was in the spirit realm or in the root system. And it dried up from the roots and the tree followed course. Well, that's God's system. He chose that. He chose things which are not to bring to naught things that are. Well, I'm sick. Well, say you're healed because you believe it. And call things which be not as though they were, and you'll have it. He chose things which are not to bring to naught things that are. That's why he's upholding all things by the word of his power. You don't see words. But the things that we do see were not made of things that we do see. It's the seen and the unseen. You live in both worlds at the same time. I prayed for a lady one time. I put my hand upon her. She had a goiter on the side of her neck, right there at her shoulder. Her right shoulder, right side of her neck. About the size of a hen egg, maybe a little larger than a hen egg. I put my hand over it. Cupped my hand over it like you'd put your hand over an egg. A hen egg. And I commanded in Jesus' name for it to die and dissolve and disappear. I didn't expect that to be as instant, but it went down under my hand. My hand flattened against her neck. In Jesus' name, I command you to die and disappear. It was gone. I mean, right now, it was gone. And I lifted my hand and I said, check it. And she reaches up there and she goes, it's gone. It's gone. It's gone. Well, the church gets excited and they're praising God. When she calms down, she asked me a question I didn't expect. She said, where did it go? Well, I didn't have time to teach her a theological lesson. But it went from the seen realm into the unseen realm. Healing came from the unseen realm into the seen realm. It's the same as a kinetic energy and a potential energy. It went into the unseen realm. See, the energy to produce that still exists. And if you believe for it, it'll come right back. If you fear it, it'll come right back. Because the potential still exists. It's just in the unseen realm. Because it's here. Sickness is here. Healing is here. I can have either one that I focus on. Well, the sick person needs to focus on the healing. Because God has chosen things which are not to bring to naught. What does naught mean? Nothing. Reduce the sickness to nothing. How? The are not is the healing. I are not healed. Well, if you'll focus on it, you will be. I are sick. Well, if you'll focus on the healing, that sickness will be reduced to nothing. That is not always instant. The fig tree dried up from the roots, but it was the next day that showed the evidence that it was withered. And you do that with your faith in God's word and you'll see results. It may be little by little. It may be progressive, but you stay with it. You'll see it. Monitor your tongue. Monitor your words. Monitor your mouth. When Lazarus is dead, you call him asleep. You just go ahead and call him asleep. And I'm going to wake him up. Don't talk plain unless you have to around the doctor maybe, but you don't need to talk plain around me or Susan or people of faith or around yourself. You don't ever have to say, well, you know, I just have to be honest. No, you don't. No, you don't. No, you don't. Don't talk plain. Talk faith. Can somebody say amen?